Let's talk about the Gulf going nuclear. The United Arab Emirates is about to flick the switch on a nuclear power plant. It's the first of its kind in the Arab world, and not everyone thinks it's a good idea.
This is the wrong reactor in the wrong place at the wrong time.
So why has the UAE decided to go nuclear? What are the risks? And why is a nuclear research reactor in Saudi Arabia adding to the nerves? Chernobyl and Fukushima, they don't exactly make nuclear reactors an easy sell. What does help, a little, is that nuclear power plants generate energy without adding to global warming. So first up, here are the basics on how it works. At the core of the process is nuclear fission. When atoms split, they release energy. That energy boils water, which creates steam, which then spins a turbine to generate electricity. It's technology that originated in the 1950s, and it's evolved since then, but it's still risky, and it's really expensive, especially when you compare it to renewable energy like wind and solar.
Every state has the right to determine its energy mix. The problem is this: nuclear costs are enormous. Renewables are between 1/5 and 1/7 the cost of nuclear.
It's why many countries seem to be powering down from nuclear energy. In 1996, global electricity generated from nuclear peaked at nearly 18%. By 2018, it fell to 10%. And in the Gulf, other sources of energy seem like no-brainers. There's plenty of sunshine, wind, and massive reserves of oil and gas. Many countries in the region are trying to diversify away from fossil fuels. The UAE already has one of the world's largest solar plants, the Noor Abu Dhabi, with more than 3 million panels. And the UAE is pushing ahead with the Arab world's first nuclear power plant. The Barakah facility is in the Emirate of Abu Dhabi, the UAE's capital. Construction has been going on since 2012, and it's been a long road of delays and overspending by billions of dollars. But now it's nearly ready to plug into the grid. In March, the first of four reactors was loaded with fuel rods. Once all four reactors are online, Barakah is expected to generate up to 25% of the UAE's electricity.
24 hours a day, 7 days a week, to help power the growth of the nation.
In 2020, we will become the first country in the region to deliver safe, commercial, and peaceful nuclear power.
But keeping the peace in this part of the world isn't easy. It's a tough neighborhood. You've got Saudi Arabia, Iran, and Israel, a triumvirate of sworn enemies, and plenty of other rivalries too. That's made it hard to build trust. And when it comes to nuclear capability, there's a long history of secrecy here. Iraq and Libya both had covert nuclear programs. Algeria built a nuclear research reactor before inviting inspectors in. Saudi Arabia is building a research reactor too, but we'll get to that later. Iran has also been accused of secrecy. It's been cast by Western countries as the region's nuclear bad boy trying to develop a bomb. Iran has always denied that, but in 2002 it did acknowledge it was building nuclear facilities that it hadn't declared. In 2007, Israel bombed what it says was a nuclear reactor in Syria, but only owned up to it in 2018. And then there's Israel itself, which refuses to confirm or deny that it has nuclear weapons, though most experts reckon it has at least 90 warheads. Safe to say that suspicions over nuclear ambitions in the region don't come out of nowhere.
If you have a civil nuclear capacity, you can then start to go towards a military nuclear capacity.
Without getting too in the weeds on this, the leap from producing nuclear power to making a weapon isn't a big one. To make electricity, you have to enrich natural uranium to 3-5%. To make a bomb, it has to be over 90%. The higher, the better. But the facility needed for both is the same. Now, the UAE has worked hard to reassure people it's not interested in building a bomb. The country signed an agreement with the International Atomic Energy Agency, the IAEA, over a decade ago to allow inspectors in on short notice. And in March, the UAE's ambassador to the US reiterated the country's peaceful intentions, saying it won't enrich its own uranium or reprocess spent nuclear fuel. Here's what he said in the Wall Street Journal. New and better rules have delivered a new, huge source of clean power and reduced the risk of nuclear proliferation. But experts we spoke to still feel the idea of turning to nuclear energy just doesn't add up.
There are no economic or energy policy or industrial reasons to build a nuclear power plant. If states, countries decide to build a nuclear power plant anyway, then we have to discuss other issues that are actually the drivers for those projects.
It's not just about fears over a potential nuclear weapon. What if Baraka gets attacked again? The UAE is fighting a war in Yemen. Here's what happened in 2017.
The UAE has denied it's been hit by a cruise missile fired by Houthi rebels in Yemen. The group's television service says they were targeting the Al Baraka nuclear reactor.
Firing the cruise missile at the UAE is an important qualitative leap.
There's an old saying, which is a nuclear power plant in a country is like a pre-deployed nuclear weapon for the enemy.
The idea is that targeting a nuclear power plant is like a nuclear weapon attack. And attacks on nuclear facilities in this region have happened before.
If you go back just even a few years, you can get to 13 aerial strikes against reactors in the region. This is not a place that allows for mere academic speculation about the possibility of someone else taking a whack at a reactor.
Last September, those same Houthi rebels who claimed to have targeted Baraka set their sights on Saudi Arabia. 18 drones and 7 cruise missiles hit Saudi oil facilities, temporarily knocking out more than half of the kingdom's oil production. You can see why people think it could happen to the Baraka reactors.
I would say that they are as vulnerable as Saudi Arabia's Abqaiq facility was, which was protected by 3 layers of missile defense.
So they might be vulnerable to attack, but what if something just goes wrong? The Baraka facility has been built by a South Korean company called KEPCO that's never exported a reactor before. And the UAE got a good deal. KEPCO's bid for the contract was reportedly about 30% cheaper than the next lowest bid.
So it's concerning that in a volatile area, these reactors are being built in what seems to be relatively a cheap and cheerful kind of way.
Paul Dorfman actually put together a safety report about Baraka last year. He compiled a list of concerns, including the discovery of cracks in the containment buildings of all 4 reactors. And UAE officials only acknowledged it a year after they were found. They say they've been fixed, but concerns about the reactors don't stop there.
It doesn't have added on protection from airplane crash missile attack. It also doesn't have what's known as a core catcher. It basically catches the core of the reactor. If anything goes wrong, and it melts down.
And if something does go wrong, what happens to that radioactive material? Well, experts who've done modeling for oil spills seem to agree that what spills in the Gulf stays in the Gulf.
The contaminated water would be moved by the tidal currents. It would be flushed back and forth. So in other words, if you had a spillage here, it would take just over 2 years to get out of the Arabian Gulf.
Al Jazeera tried to ask officials from the UAE's nuclear and energy bodies about some of these concerns, but they never got back to us. And that brings us back to the issue of openness, not just from the UAE, but across the region. Take Saudi Arabia, for instance. It's building a nuclear research reactor, which some see as the first step in any nuclear program. And the kingdom says it plans to build 16 nuclear facilities by 2040. But they're moving ahead without IAEA inspectors checking the design and build.
Saudi have also started to make, and have been making quite consistently, deeply problematic statements about enrichment, in other words, proliferation, in other words, weapons.
And that takes on more significance given the kingdom's position on Iran.
Without a doubt, if Iran developed a nuclear bomb, we will follow suit as soon as possible.
Saudi Arabia and the UAE are allies. There's no suspicion of a nuclear arms race there. But there are other countries that don't get along, and anything can happen, whether it's an accident or something more sinister.
The point about these risks, these so-called low probability but high impact risks, is that they really do happen. And when they happen, you really can write off a lot of people's lives.
Low probability but high impact. Nuclear energy anywhere carries risks. Now it's a reality on the Arabian Peninsula. This episode is based on research by Patricia Sabga, who's the managing business editor at Al Jazeera Online. You can find her work on our website. I'll see you all next week.